We find that in the life of Samson and Delilah, we will find that they lived a life that was not so pleasing in the sight of God. Let's find out just some of the things, if you will, that they did in the presence of God that was not pleasing in the sight of God. Let us look at the life of Samson and Delilah. We find that the games that they played, we find that some people are still playing those same games today. You got to understand, brothers and sisters, that Samson was a man of God, but Delilah was a woman of the world. Right. Talk to me, somebody. Right. But I want you to understand, brothers and sisters, although Samson was a man of God and Delilah was a woman of the world, understand that both of them was playing games. Some of us need to look around today, even in the church and out of the church, we find a whole lot of church folks still playing games. Talk to me, if you will. We find that love was not really love with Samson and Delilah. It's happening right here today in the world. We find that people are not in love anymore. They are more in lust. I wish I had a praying church here. Don't let nobody fool you here now, brothers and sisters. I believe that there was a time in your life where you could really say, I was really in love with that person. It's not like your mama, not like your daddy. They loved them for who they really were. They did not love them for what they could do for them, but they loved them because of who they was. Do I have a witness here? Love is not love anymore. Love seemed to be transferred into lust. We will find, brothers and sisters, that the love of money was more important than the love of God. Do I have any witnesses here? Some of us in this room need to say amen, if you will, because you can see now that the love of money seemed to be more important than the love of God. I just believe that when it comes to God, if there's some things you don't need to sell out on. Do I have a witness here? I just believe when it comes to God, you don't need to sell God out for an extra $50. Oh, I just stepped on somebody's toes here. I believe when it comes to God, amen, I don't think that I would sell out for extra $50 when I'm a musician or when I'm a preacher, but I'm going to leave this because I'm getting an extra $50, but you spend that extra $50 playing the lottery. I wish I had a witness in here. You spend the extra $50 at the spirit store. Oh, y'all know what I'm talking about. Talk to me, somebody. I just believe that some things, amen, in life is worth fighting for. And working in the body of Christ and serving God is worth fighting for. Too many people putting money before God. There is a song. There is a song, and maybe some of you all that's younger than I am, maybe some of you all that's younger can remember this song that came out just a few months ago, maybe a year ago, maybe it hadn't been that long, and the song says, I'm feeling myself. And then it says, I'm feeling myself. Oh, y'all sitting there like y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Some of y'all, anybody ever heard that song, I'm feeling myself? I know some of y'all too spiritual for me. So let me talk to those that want to be real. But there's a song that come out, I'm feeling myself. I'm feeling myself. And that seems to be the problem today. More people want to feel themselves instead of feeling the presence of God. I see all the time, I hear all the time, and I see on Facebook all the time, and I hear people all the time when they dress up and they try to look cute and they think they got it going on. They just wave their hand and say, I'm feeling myself. Well, if you ain't feeling God, you ain't feeling nothing. But too many people trying to feel themselves. Well, let me just put it in plain terms. Too many people are trying to please themselves but don't want to please God. Look at somebody and say, you're real sensitive today. You got to understand, brothers and sisters, that the world is in trouble because too many people are trying to feel themselves. It's all about pleasing me. It's just please me. But whatever happened to pleasing God? Whatever happened to doing what God has called you to do? So if you will, let's look at the life of Samson and Delilah. Are there any Samsons in the house? Are there any Delilahs in the house? You ain't got to say amen. Amen, preacher. Understand, a person, greatest accomplishments may well be helping others to accomplish great things. Talk to me, somebody. Come here, son. If you want to know what kind of character you have, some of your greatest accomplishments is not only thinking about yourself, but your greatest accomplishment is, I'm going to deny myself and I'm going to help somebody else. Your greatest accomplishment should not be about me and my, but your greatest accomplishment should be, if I can help somebody else get to where God wants them to be, then I'm doing what God will have me to do. But no. We don't want to help somebody else to get where God wants them to be, because if I help him to get where God wants him to be, guess what? If he go up, I go up. And he may be the person to help open doors for me because I help. Oh, y'all don't hear me here. Thank you, son. Your greatest accomplishment in life is helping other people to get where God wants them to be. Anybody ever helped you get to where God wants you to be? But on the other hand, a person's greatest failure may be preventing others from achieving greatness that God has in store for them because of the problem you're having in your life. Come back up here again, son. Your greatest failure can be hindering somebody else from getting to where God wants them to be because you got some junk in your life, whether it's jealousy, whether it's hatred, whether it's malice, whether you have a personal problem, and because I'm not where I want to be, I'm going to try to pull you down along with me. Thank you, son. Oh, you ain't got to say amen, sir. Some of y'all got some friends like that. Some of y'all got some girlfriends like that. Jealousy is a terrible thing. But if you want people, amen, to be blessed, then deny yourself and do something to help somebody else. If you can't high five somebody, just look at somebody and say, I'm going to help you because it ain't about all the time what I can do for me, but what I can do for you. The Bible said, amen, if my brother rejoice, I ought to rejoice with him. If I be sad, he ought to be sad too. So I wish I had a witness here. If he go up, I go up. If he go down, I go down. But church folk, if you really want to know what kind of Christian you are, then deny yourself and try to help somebody else. Oh, you got preachers like that. Oh, you didn't go there, did you, Bishop? You got preachers like that. They don't want to try to help you to do. It's all about them. Sometimes you even have family folk like that. Amen. They're jealous of where you are. They're trying to pull you back down. Let the church say, amen. So your greatest failure can be preventing other people from getting to where they want to be because you have a problem with you. But Jesus would have me to share with you in Matthew chapter 5, to those of you that have your Bibles, this is what he said in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 44. He said, but I say unto you, love what? Your enemies. Isn't it hard to love somebody that just got through cussing you out? Isn't it hard to love somebody that done you wrong? Isn't it hard to love somebody that smiled in your face and stabbed you in your back? Talk to me, somebody. But Jesus said, love your what? Your enemy. Here it is. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. Oh man, I had to really pray because you start wondering, God, I ain't never did nothing to this sister. I never did nothing to this brother. Why they just don't like me? But God said, teach Bishop, do good to them that hate you and pray for them which what? Despitefully use you and persecute you. Why, Bishop? Because in verse 45, under verse 44, it said, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. When you can do what the Bible said, to love people who do you wrong, then you identify yourself as being a child of God. Teach, Bishop. Somebody say Delilah. Delilah was a woman that was motivated by greed. It was all about what she could get. You got men, you got women, it's all about what they can get, but they don't want to give nothing. Talk to me, somebody. But the Lord said, it's more blessed. Oh, I got some Bible readers in here. It's more blessed to give than it is to receive. But you got more folk, amen, that want to receive, but they don't want to give. But God said you're more blessed when you can give than when you can receive. Teach, Bishop Gary. And so she was more about greed in receiving. Her persistence was to wear down Samson. I'm here to tell somebody there's something out there that's trying to wear you down. Teach, Bishop. They're trying to wear you down to keep you from serving God. Oh, I wish I had a praying church. There's something going on in church folk life that's wearing them down, that's keeping them from serving the Lord. Keeping them from singing in the choir. Keeping them from serving what God has called them to serve. What's weighing you down? Even your past can weigh you down. But the Bible said, forgetting those things which are behind me. You need to elbow somebody and say, you need to forget about that past. It's time for you to press forward because your past can weigh you down.